Okay, so it's my pleasure to introduce my friend and colleague, Dr. Beatrice Kayubi-Labata. Bia has a PhD in social anthropology from State University of Campinas in Brazil. Her main interests are the study of psychoactive substances, drug policy, shamanism, ritual, and religion. She's a visiting professor at the Center for Research and Postgraduate Studies in Social Anthropology in Guadalajara, and adjunct assistant professor in the drug policy program of the Center for Economic Research and Education in Aguascalientes, Mexico. She's also the co-founder of the Nucleus for Interdisciplinary Studies of Psychoactives, NAEP, and the editor of NAEP's website. She is co-author, and co-editor of 12 books, one special edition journal, and several peer-reviewed articles, of which I'm happy to say a couple were co-authored with me. I also want to make a plug for Bia's most recent book, co-edited with Clancy Kavnar, Ayahuasca Shamanism in the Amazon and Beyond, and I think Bia has a few copies for sale if anybody wants to come and purchase one. So with this, I will hand it over to Bia to deliver her talk. Thanks, Bia.
So hello, everybody. As said, my name is Beatrice Kayubi-Labate. I go usually by my nickname, Bia Labate. And I am Brazilian, and I'm an anthropologist. And I have pretty much dedicated my whole career for about the last 20 years to studying shamanism, ritual religion, drug policy. And my specialty has been a lot ayahuasca. So this is... We have a saying in Portuguese, it's ask monkeys if they like bananas. That's how I feel in this conference. I'm in my element. This is the kind of thing that I like and that I appreciate. And I want to thank the organizers for having me here. And I decided that I'm not going to do a very academic lecture because it's not the nature of the conference. So I'm kind of going to make something more loose, different than normally what I do, which is more formal. But basically, I wanted to tell like an update. I would say this is like an observatory report of like what's going on in Brazil, what's shifting, what's new in our context in Brazil. So just to give you, I don't know how familiar you are with all of this, but just to give you a general idea, in Brazil, what has been strongest in the public debate is the use of ayahuasca by the Brazilian ayahuasca churches, religiões ayahuasqueiras brasileiras, or Brazilian ayahuasca religions. That's a category some colleagues and I created, which kind of became real and present in the debate. So this category is not so much the auto-description of the groups, but an anthropological classification, which puts together the three main branches, which are Santo Daime, UDV, and Barquinha. These three main branches, they are all doing kind of a similar process of Christianization of the use of ayahuasca, which is this transition from the plant in the pharmacopoeia of the healers, the curanderos, the shamans, related to a series of other plants, to becoming a Christian sacrament. So Brazil, differently than the other Latin American countries, is not so, doesn't have such a strong, in the public debate or in the public imaginary, the indigenous element is not so strong. It's not so present as it is in other Latin American countries, for example, Peru or Bolivia or Mexico. So in Brazil, what has happened basically was that these churches, which emerged, they started kind of forming maybe the oldest ones in the 1930s and then the Barquinha in the 1950s, the UDV in the 1960s, and sort of in the 70s, 80s, they expanded beyond the Amazon. And what happened there was that because we have a kind of weak indigenous presence in the imaginary of us as a country, these religions, they kind of occupied a space of tradition, of roots, of deep links to the Amazon, and they became represented publicly and understood, narrated as the traditional use of ayahuasca. So in Brazil, what is understood is that the traditional, the roots, the real thing is these religions. And there was a process of debate and dispute around the legitimation of these religions, because in the 80s they were persecuted by the state. So the state listed ayahuasca as a forbidden substance. This was in 1985. And then they came together, they brought together this research committee called Interdisciplinary Research Committee that evaluated the use of ayahuasca in these religions. So it was a pretty progressive take in terms of public policy, because it was progressive in the way that it put together public authorities, the government, the representatives of the religions, the users, which it should be something kind of obvious that these people who are using should be heard. But as we know, normally that's not the case in public policy, that they don't have this incredible idea to call the users to talk to them about what they do. And scientists. Being in the scientists, hey, not medical doctors, but also anthropologists. So Brazil, in a kind of funky, mystical, spontaneous way, created a new paradigm, which blew everybody's mind. I was coming to the ayahuasca scene when this had already happened, so I was not like among the people that did it, but my friends were, and we were all excited because the government, after 2 years of evaluation, which included, hey, let's go take ayahuasca in the churches. Let's go there and see what they do. Wow, isn't that incredible? Yes, it's like kind of basic, but revolutionary in terms of public policy, which is actually to have the authorities go check out what's happening. So they had 2 year meetings with this interdisciplinary committee with this multiple voices, and they visited the communities in the Amazon, and they visited the communities in the cities, and you had the medical doctors and the judges purging, and you had the charisma from the drinkers, and you had all sorts of like mystical tales on the side, because this one famous lawyer, he took his children or young sons with him to participate. Like, he really wanted to make things right, and he took his family with him. And then the family got totally excited with Santo Daime, ended up opening a Santo Daime church. And in Brazil, things have evolved in this kind of interesting intersection with a lively crossing between the users, the scientific committee, the experts, and the government representatives. So Brazil created this kind of super cool, innovative model, which is to allow the ritual and religious use of ayahuasca. Okay, this model was exported. Hey, we influenced the USA. We exported Santo Daime and the UDV to the US. And then here in the US, using the idea of religious freedom, the UDV fought a case all the way to the Supreme Court. It was a preliminary injunction. There's lots of like legal backgrounds that I'm not gonna get into. I have a couple of papers written about that. I really like this topic. And anyway, in the US, the UDV got legitimized and recognized, which opened a path for the Santo Daime to also get recognized. The Santo Daime was first recognized in Oregon. And guess what? It's just been recognized in LA. I think that's really incredible. There's a person from the Santo Daime Church here, which is Vicky Kraft, that I think it's a highlight that should be giving, you know, a keynote, because they just applied with the DEA and they got this permission, and everything kind of cool and kind of soft and kind of easy and kind of under the radar. But I'm going totally away from my topic, so I'm gonna go back. What happened in Brazil is, you had this model, ritual religious use of ayahuasca, the churches, the Christianity, the moral views on ayahuasca, which is kind of moralizing, purging. There's lots of analysis of what was going on. This legislation, while it was very good and advanced a lot of things and influenced the US, influenced Canada, influenced Spain, influenced Holland, kind of worked in this silence arena, where you didn't really have indigenous people doing their thing for people like us. So the whole, I'm presenting it very simplified and a little reductionistic, but I don't know how to convey better for, you know, this crowd and what I want to say here, what I said, this update on what is happening. What is happening is that, so, you know, you had in the Amazon the religions, then they expanded to the urban centers of the rest of Brazil. And then when they got into urban centers like the 80s, the 90s, this totally popped. It blended with everything. It blended with yoga, it blended with primal therapy, it blended with Hinduism, it blended with artists, it blended with people that wanna help homeless people, musicians that wanna jam and, you know, see God through music. You had this vibrant like outburst of all sorts of multiple ayahuasca variations. So in my master, I studied what I called the reinvention of the use of ayahuasca in the urban centers, and I invented this little name called neo-ayahuasqueros to refer to these branches that were splinter branches from the matrixes, Daime and UDV, and sort of created this whole plurality. But interestingly, always with a religious and ritual kind of spirit. So even if people were variating, there was always this strong need and wish to have ritual, to have community, to have a kind of set. So there wasn't very much a psychonautic culture being born. There was, you know, Afro variation, a Rasta variation, a spiritist variation, but all kind of related to the same general model of ritual and religion. And what happened more recently since like the 2000s or maybe 2005 is that the Indians who were invisible in their lands drinking ayahuasca since a long time, they popped into the scene. They got into the urban ayahuasca scene. That's actually where my lecture should start, I'm sorry, but it's a lot of things to say. So I was going there, in my master I studied this guy, who then he became this famous guru. He was not a guru when I studied him. His name is Prem Baba. Now he kind of like not acknowledges that he drinks Daime, which makes me a little bit upset. But he was a Daime guy that became a guru. So that was like the reinvention of the urban uses. As I said, it was a whole variation of Daime and UDV. And then what in my PhD, I studied, the title of my PhD is called Ayahuasca Mamankuna Merci Beaucoup. The internationalization and diversification of the Peruvian ayahuasca vegetalismo. And then in the PhD, I was studying this phenomena of gringos becoming shamans and shamans going to scientific conferences and these retreat centers in Peru and this, you know, Nahuatl world and Pucallpa and all this expansion of this ayahuasca shamanism model. So my master was about the religion, the neo-religions, and my PhD was about the neo-vegetalistas, was about this encounter between Westerns and locals. And then, like in one phrase, also again, reducing a little, Brazil is being Peruvianized. Like, the model of Peru is kind of migrating to Brazil. So what happens now is that we have a hybrid scene that we just don't have the religions anymore, because before the religions, they were really, really fighting to see which one was more legitimate than the other, which one was more traditional. I drank with that mestre received from that mestre, and that's the original thing, and everybody that is doing something different is clandestine, illegal, or is, you know, is not really in the rules. And now the Indians got out of the villages and are giving ayahuasca all over the place. And this made a complete mess in the symbolic power division of tradition and authenticity. And I'm just having a lot of fun. I think it's great because also they do things that are completely like politically incorrect. Like they do these festivals that maybe you have like this, you know, dance that people separate men and women and then they go dancing and then they meet in the middle and then they have one to have to touch the breasts and the dick very fast and kind of fight and then separate and they do everything, a lot of festivities naked, they give ayahuasca to everybody, they call the press, they call media, they call tourists, they make packages. So it's a little bit like curious to understand what's going on. And this communication was a little bit, I just wanted to show you some maps to illustrate. You can't see that picture, but it's so cool because the Indian, he has a headdress, and then he's wearing a headphone because he's being translated, but the headphone doesn't fit in the headdress, so he put the headphone upside down. And that's what I call, you know, attempt of symmetrical transmission of knowledge. So the part that is the wide green is the legal Amazon. It's very large. It's a big part of Brazil. And then the other part that is the darker green is the Amazon part. Also, you could go more like to Pará, but mainly that more green part is where you have ayahuasca in the Amazon. So just for you to have an idea, I am from São Paulo. So for me to go to the Amazon, it's like almost like an American going to the Amazon. It's really far away. And Brasília and Rio. So these things, they went right from the Amazon, and then they spread to the rest of Brazil. Then you have the group, the Huniquim, the Kaxinawa. This group is one of the most active now. They just bonded with this super cool, modern, contemporary artist, very well succeeded, very dynamic, very creative, very visionary, called Ernesto Neto. And they're doing installations where they recreate like the mythology of ayahuasca use in a maloca kind of style in museums. And then they do rituals inside the museums. And they have done this in Vienna, and they have done this in Spain, and they have done this in São Paulo. And they have this whole, you know, flow of Europeans and people from South Africa going to their region and doing ayahuasca rituals. They have a whole group of followers called Guardiões da Floresta, the guardians of not the floresta, guardians, guardiões, that are groups that follow them and support them. And they also have connected to the Red Path, Camino Rojo, and they're promoting some like hybrid ceremonies. So the Kaxinawa are probably the pioneer in this movement. In 2005, I made friends with this guy, Leopardo, and he's the brother of Fabiano that was in the first slide. And basically, he went to São Paulo to study. He's the son of Cian, who's a great leadership, and he wanted to get his studies. So he went to the city to study. And then he started to do ayahuasca on the side. So we started to witness this thing. All of a sudden, like back in the day, it was just Daime and UDV, and then, you know, this whole bunch of new variations. But now you have a guy like him as well. Then you have the Yawanawa family. It's also Pano, so it's the same linguistic group that is the Shipibo and the Kaxinawa. And the Yawanawa, they are promoting and they are engaged in these big festivals that they receive tourists for like 5 days. And this is what anthropologists call the revitalization of culture. So through these big festivities, they are kind of celebrating and rescuing and affirming their identity. And ayahuasca has had a central role. So this interest from foreigners have also helped them in a way with this process of kind of pride. But there are many complexities to the whole picture. I'm not making this apology that this is so nice. It's interesting, but there are problems. I just want you to have an idea of geography in this